Friday evening. Men are meeting here at the church and leaving at 4 o'clock. We're as close to it as we can. And we're going to Syracuse. It's $20 registration fee, but they have a Friday night, Saturday service. We're all going to the Friday night. If you want to go and stay over, you can go ahead and find a hotel. But the author or co-author of the book, Every Man's Battle, is going to be sharing. It's going to be a great time of ministry. So men, that's Friday night, 4 o'clock here at the church. We're heading up and coming back. Thursday night, men's prayer. I've heard this week from several, I think God's going to lead me to come on Thursday nights, Pastor. And I say, amen, praise God. I've heard from several new faces. And last week, we had quite a new group. So guys, step up to the plate. And you know what? As you have been stepping up to the plate, God's been working. Amen? God's been moving. There are situations that God is just meeting and supplying. Then Saturday, men are on Thursday and Friday, but the women are, they've got a doubleheader on Saturday at 9 o'clock. You have breakfast, amen, at the Old Country Buffet. And you'll be gathering there. And then following that, there's crafts here at the church around 11. Amen. And so if you want to help make crafts or donate crafts, don't donate the material for crafts. Donate some craft you've done and made or created. They're going to be sold so that we can expedite next year's women's conference and put some money towards it. It's going to be a great conference and you want to be a part of it. So ladies, that's coming. And then one more announcement, if you have to miss one Sunday. Last week was proof positive. You never know what you're going to miss. And if you have to miss one Sunday, I guarantee you, you do not want to miss this Sunday. I'm planning to preach what I planned to preach last Sunday. Let the fire fall. But I guess God just did that. Instead of letting me preach it, he just performed it. Amen? So you never know what he'll do this week. If he did it last week and no 2 weeks are the same, you don't want to miss this Sunday. Tonight I want you to turn to the Gospel of Isaiah. I believe that Isaiah is the closest thing to the Gospel in the Old Testament. We have the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. In the Old Testament, the Gospels were not written, but Isaiah is the closest thing to the Gospels. It is a replica of the Word of God in its entirety. The book of Isaiah is 66 books long. The first 39 are books of judgment, and the second 27 are books of God's supply, provision, and victory. Amen? Just as the first 39 of the Old Testament are books of the law, the next 27 are books of grace. Amen? And so Isaiah correlates to the entire Word of God. And tonight we're picking up in chapter 44. I'm just going to read 3 verses of Scripture. We're going to talk about a great outpouring tonight. I'm going to preach, teach. We'll have conversation, communication. Phil said to me, you're not going to do anything to us like you did last Wednesday, are you? Because last Wednesday was a tough one, wasn't it? Amen? And I told him, I said, no, we were not trying to get young people to rebel against older people. Because the young prophet listened to the old prophet and got himself in trouble. That doesn't mean that don't listen to your elders. It means listen to God, and maybe you need to listen to your elders because they're speaking for God. Amen? A lot of our elders have a lot more wisdom than we do, but the truth of it is you can't blame Mom and Dad or Aunt Jemima or Uncle Sam for your problems. Amen? You got to be responsible for the decisions you make, no matter how young, old, or indifferent you are. Amen? You're going to give an account to God. But tonight, we're going to, as I begin to read through the Scripture and begin to ponder it, I realize how it goes along with what we're preaching on Sundays and what God's doing in bringing revival to Central Assembly. Verses 1 to 3 of Isaiah 44. Yet now hear, O Jacob my servant, and Israel whom I have chosen. Thus saith the Lord that made thee and formed thee from the womb, which will help thee, Fear not, O Jacob, my servant, and thou, Jeshurun, whom I have chosen. For I will pour water on him that is thirsty, and floods upon the dry ground. I will pour my spirit upon thy seed, and my blessing upon thine offspring. Lord, I pray you grant us grace and insight and inspiration tonight. I pray, Lord, that the word that you've given would be shared in such a manner as to be received and accepted and applied by the hearer. I pray, God, tonight that everything that we say and do would be from the mouth of God and not merely the mind of man. And I pray that we glorify you, O Lord. Father, your will be done, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. God's people have just endured a lot of hardship. Amen. Israel has been captive to Assyria, and Judah has been the captive of Babylon. And now God, at a time when their faith is depleted and their strength is diminished, God is giving Israel, or all of Israel, including Judah, a word of encouragement. You know, sometimes we look at our past and we see the difficulties we've been through, we see the hardships, we see the turmoil and the test, and when we came here, we were in a difficult time in the church. It was a tough time. It was a time where there was a depletion, a time when there was a lack, and God is reviving, and the message that we've been bringing, that God has been delivering, is I want to revive my church. Amen? And you can't revive something that's already healthy. You revive something that's not healthy, and as a matter of fact, it's even dead. And so God's saying that even though you've been through a time of depletion and a time where you've been diminished, I am going to pour out upon you. And this is the word I believe God has been speaking to Central for some time now, and I don't believe he's changed his message. I believe it's the same tonight that it's been since the beginning of our tenure here. God wants to pour out in these last days in order to revive this, his church. Amen? And there are three items that God says that he's going to pour out on Israel. The first thing he says in verse 3 is, "For I will pour water on him that is thirsty, and I will pour floods upon the dry ground." Does anybody have any idea what the prophet is referring to when he talks about pouring water on the thirsty and floods on the dry ground?
Sorry.
Somebody got a word of knowledge. Actually, in the text, it is a metaphor for grace. How many know if we've been depleted, the greatest gift, if we're dead, the greatest gift we can receive is grace?
Amen.
How many know the church needs God's grace?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We need water on the dry ground. When you're down and when you have been beaten over the head, I had someone in my office today that just had a setback in their life and it took a tumble, and I just told them, I said, "Listen, now's the time that God wants to replenish and refresh and revive your spirit. It's not time to let the devil hit you with shame and blame," because how many know when you're down, that's when the devil tries to pile on top of you and suffocate you and smother you and to keep you from standing up again. And the whole thing that God wants to do is when you've been knocked down to get you back on your feet. Amen. He told the man who was carried in and lowered in, "Take up your bed and walk. Get on your feet." The man at the gate, beautiful Peter, lifted him up and got him on his feet. And that's what God wants to do, is to get us back up and get us standing on our own and get us. And when the devil knows that we've been knocked down, he wants to jump on immediately and make the weight a little heavier, make the load a little tougher, and make it a little more difficult for us to stand. But God said, "I'm going to pour out my grace on your life." I don't know about you, but I like to hear that. Amen?
Amen.
Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all my sin. Amen. Hallelujah. I will pour water on him that is thirsty. Well, as you look for water, you understand water is necessary for life. You know, with this age of computers and instant access to, you know, wisdom and knowledge and intellect and all the answers that you can get off the internet, because you know if it's on the internet, it's true. But it does make study a little more efficient and effective. And of course, I knew this as a kid, but I looked it up just to be sure. How long can we go without water physically? Until we die. All right, Smarty. They say 3 days. And it has been, on occasion, some have gone 8 to 10 days, but that is very rare. Don't try it. 3 days is about the average. You can go for a month and a half. You can go for 40, 50, 60 days without food, but you can only go 3 days without water. He said, I'm going to pour water on him that is thirsty. How do we know that water is necessary for life? If God sees that we are in a time of depletion, the first thing he wants to do is put a little water on the weeds. Amen? Because sometimes the plant looks like a weed. And it's really a plant because it's just withered. Isaiah 55, verses 1 and 2 said what? Does grace ignore sin? Did Jesus ignore her sin? He looked at her and he looked at the accusers and he began to write in the sand and he said to the Pharisees, to the religious people, he said, "Let him that is without sin cast the first stone," and conviction came on them and they left. He turned to her and he said, "Where are those thine accusers?" And she looked around and she said, "Lord, I have none." And he said, "Neither do I condemn thee." But he didn't stop there. Go party on. He said, "Stop what you're doing. I'm giving you grace, but grace doesn't turn a blind eye to wrong action." Amen? Grace does not give you a carte blanche license to do whatever you want. Grace, you know, that's what's happened in the church today. We believe in what they call cheap grace. Grace was never cheap. It cost Jesus his whole life. Every drop of blood he shed was grace. It was grace. Amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. And it was grace that stepped in and gave her life. So the first thing he said, "I'm going to pour water on him that is thirsty." Do you remember what it says about Noah? When God was going to destroy the earth with a flood and all of man was about to be wiped out, there was going to be no more humanity, but Noah found grace. I haven't preached it here yet, but I preached on, did you find grace or did grace find you? Noah found grace. Most of the time, grace has to find us because we're going the opposite direction of God, and God is gracious. We're going the other way, but grace catches us and wrestles us to the ground. But Noah found grace because he was walking on the same path and the same plan and the same plane that God was on. He was on the same path that grace walked. He found grace. But in most cases, grace has to find us because we're going away from God, and grace has to track us down. Amen? And Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. And because of grace, what happened to humanity? God came down and made a way of escape so that we would have life to continue where death was about to dominate. See, water gives life. Water gives life. The second thing that I learned about water is a cleansing agent, isn't it? When they went into the tabernacle and later on the temple, they would come from the brazen altar where sacrifice was made and blood was shed. And when you have spent time butchering, you get a little bit dirty. Having done a little butchering in my life, I realize that you get it on you. And it just so happens, I know I like hunting so well, it's because the priest was a butcher. I like a little blood on my hands every once in a while. One of my friends says, you get miserable if you don't get a little blood on your hands. That's why God was gracious to me in letting me get that deer this year. He didn't want me miserable. But after they left that brazen altar where sacrifice was made, before they would go into service in the sanctuary, in the holy place, what was on the outside of the holy place before they would go in? The laver. The water. The Bible talks about the washing of the water by the word of God. Amen? Water is a cleansing agent. Before they would go in, they would have to stop and wash up and clean themselves in the laver. Ephesians 2, 8, and 9, talking about water as a metaphor of grace. "For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast." It's a cleansing agent. By grace you're saved. Forgiveness comes because of grace. Not just your works, not my works. It's not of works. It's at his work. It's the work Christ did, not the work that man does. 1 John 1, verses 7 through 9.
But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
The blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us. What was the shedding of his blood? It was a crucifixion, wasn't it? And isn't that where grace was extended? God's riches at Christ's expense. That's where grace cleanses us from all sin. Grace erased the sinful past of a thief who hung on a cross in a moment. A lifetime of sin was washed clean by grace when he said, Lord, remember thou me when thou comest into thy kingdom. And Jesus said, today thou shalt be with me in paradise. You haven't served me a day in your life, but because of grace, I'm going to cleanse your past. I'm going to wash you clean. I thank God that he's pouring out grace. How many know that we need the cleansing of God?
Amen.
Amen. We need God to step into our lives to give us spiritual life. We need grace in order to have revival, because revival is the restoration of life, and water gives life. Without grace, there is no revival. Revival is simply an essence of God giving us what we don't deserve. That's what revival is. Revival is nothing we earn. It's nothing we deserve. It's nothing we purchase, nothing we pay for. It is nothing we produce. It is grace. And God said, I'm not a God of the dead. I'm a God of the living. Oh, man, I can start preaching tonight. Glory to God. I thank God it's grace that sends revival. It's grace that he pours out on us in order to restore life. Not only does water give life, not only does water cleanse, but water refreshes and replenishes. Amen? I talked about it a moment ago, but he said, I'll pour water on him that is thirsty and floods on the dry ground. We had a dry summer. And the lawn where the parsonage is and where Jennifer and I reside got awful brown. Sid mowed it, but he didn't have to mow it as much this year as he has in the past, because there were days it just browned. But then when the rain came, all of the deadness of the brown grass turned green. Something about water that refreshes when you're wilted, when you're withered, when you're tired, and when you're worn. In 2 Corinthians 12, 9 and 10, Paul had prayed for God to deliver him from a thorn in the flesh, from a problem, from a situation. And what did Jesus say to him? My grace is enough. Because my strength will be made perfect in your weakness. Amen? My strength will flow in when you don't have any strength, when you're withered, when you're wilted. That's what we said, that, you know, extreme revival, we preached a few weeks ago. The greatest time for revival is when the need is the greatest. You have an extreme need, you'll have extreme revival. That's the first catalyst. And when you are so needy that you can't make it without him. You can't do it without him. You can't survive without him. Grace steps in where your faith falls short, where you're weak and you can't do what you ought to be doing. God steps in and does for you what you can't do for yourself. And if we're ever going to have revival, we need God to step in and do what we can't, like he did on Sunday morning. Amen. I was talking to the woman tonight on the phone just before service, and she said, well, Pastor, What incredible service Sunday was. She said God's presence was really there. She said, I'm a tough cookie. I am a hard nut to crack, and I'm at the verge of weeping and crying because God's presence was so real. This was from someone that wouldn't be talking like that normally. But I want to tell you, that's grace. That's water on him that is thirsty. If nobody else needed a little bit of moisture on the dry ground, I needed Sunday. Yes. Amen?
Amen?
Sunday was for me if it wasn't for anybody else. I'll tell you right now, I took a hold of what God wanted to do, and I'm just looking for more. Amen?
Yes.
He gave me enough to get me through the week, but I want a little bit more because I'm going to have another battle with the devil. Amen?
You're speaking, I'd like to show this. You have a note in my Bible that says, grace should not be considered as a guarantee, but we should be concerned that God's grace can keep us faithful for us to stay strong for God. For God during the time of issues.
Amen. Grace is provision to stay strong
right.
In the hard time. That's what he said, he'll replenish you. They that wait upon the Lord renew their strength. That's because of grace. Amen. Remember Elijah when he was depleted to the point of wanting to die? How many know he just had revival and the next day needed revival? That's amazing. God can come down in power and glory like he did Sunday, and on Monday we're suicidal. Sunday, the glory filled the temple. Sunday, the Shekinah filled the house. And on Monday, people are already down in the dumps. That's Elijah ministry right there, buddy. Kill me. I just called fire down from heaven. I just slew 450 prophets of Baal. Man, did we have church last night, so today I'm suicidal, so kill me. Yeah. And what happened when Elijah didn't have it? Grace. When he was depleted and he was withered and he was wilted and he was worn out, God sent an angel to replenish and to restore. I will pour water on him that is thirsty and floods on the dry ground. God said, in order to bring revival, not only to the church, but to you as an individual, because I said it before, I believe corporate revival flows out of individual revival, and as we get revived, the church will have revival.
Amen.
But as we're depleted, the church will be depleted because you are the church, and I am the church. Amen? And if we are down, the church is going to be down because the church is a reflection of where we're at. Amen? So if you start looking at it from a real sense, where are you at? Do you need God to step in and refresh you? Do you need God to pour in something that replenishes you? Have you wilted? Have you withered? Have you dried up? Have you been worn out? It's time to drink from the waters of refreshment. Amen? Times of refreshing. Acts 3:19. Repent, therefore, and be converted when times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. Amen. Oh, I need you. Yes, I need you. Every hour I need you. That's what Sunday was. It was refreshment from the presence of the Lord. Amen. It was more than just a feel-good service. It was refreshment. Somebody needed it. If nobody else, I did. So the first thing God says I want to pour out on a church that needs revival is I'm going to pour out grace. Undeserved favor. The second thing he says is, and I will pour out my spirit upon my seed. I will pour out my spirit. Somebody read Joel 2:28. Pour out.
Empty.
saturate, pour out. Does it mean showers of blessing? Showers of blessing we need. Mercy drops round us are falling, but for the showers we plead. Is that what it means? I say torrents of blessing. Torrents of blessing. I don't want no shower money. Whoever wrote that song, God bless you, stick there, but I'm getting a little farther. Amen. I'm not going to criticize your depth, but I'm going to tell you right now, I need a whole lot more than what you need. Maybe you got a little more than I got, but I need torrents of blessing. When he said, I'll pour out, you're taking a pitcher and you pour it on somebody, they're getting the whole thing. Amen. And how many know that he's limitless? How we know he's measureless? Be not drunk with wine wherein is excess. You drink excess of wine, you're going to get drunk. But be filled with the Spirit. He didn't say, I'll trickle down upon. He said, I will pour out. Amen? I will pour floods upon the dry ground. How we know God wants to pour more of his Spirit than we can contain? He don't want you drunk with the bottle stuff. He wants you under the influence of the anointing of the Holy Ghost. He wants to come on down and take over. Pour it out, Lord. Pour it out. I don't want just a little dewdrop. Amen? How about God to pour out from on high? You know, in the Old Testament, they never knew. Before the flood, rather, they never knew what rain was. It was just dew from the ground. That would never have filled me. I need the rain to fall from heaven. Amen. He said, I will pour out my Spirit without measure. Acts 2:14. Peter standing up with the 11 lift up his voice and said, ye men of Israel, hearken to my words. Oh, that's 22. I'm quoting the wrong one. Ye men of Judea and all ye that dwell in Jerusalem, be this known unto you. Hearken to my words. These men are not drunken as ye suppose, seeing it is but the third hour of the day. But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel, and it shall come to pass in the last days, saith God. Amen. I will pour out my Spirit. I need his grace, but I need his Spirit. Amen. I need his grace, but I need his Spirit. And I don't need just a little of his grace. I need a whole lot of his grace. How about you? Amen. I'm just talking for me. I'm not saying anything about anybody out there. I need a lot of grace. That's why he'll pour out his grace on me. He won't just trickle down his grace. I need his Spirit. I don't just need a little of his Spirit. I need all of his Spirit. Amen. It is not by might. It is not by power. It is by my Spirit, so I will pour out of my Spirit. We need God to pour out the Holy Ghost in these last days. We need him to pour out the Spirit of God in this church. Let me tell you a little bit about the Spirit of God. Number one, it's a spirit of promise. Acts 1 and verse 4.
And being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, ye have heard of me.
It goes on, for John baptized you with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. This is the spirit of promise. This was not an afterthought. Pentecost was in God's program from the dawn of time. Pentecost was not a last-minute idea to spark a dead church. Amen? You see, if you start to read the four feasts of the Old Testament, you'll find that the Feast of Pentecost was 50 days after the Feast of Passover. The Feast of Passover was representative of the sacrificial lamb. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. That was the salvation experience. That is Calvary in the New Testament. 50 days later was the Feast of Pentecost, and it was a celebration of the giving of the law on Mount Sinai, where the fire came down and the smoke came and the cloud came. And on the day of Pentecost, 50 days after the lamb was sacrificed, on the day of Pentecost, the fire fell. The smoke came. The glory filled the house. Amen. You see, even back in the Old Testament, Pentecost was already pictured. It was already provided for. Pentecost was not just a last-minute decision after Calvary occurred. Pentecost was God's idea before the foundation of the earth, just as Calvary was. The lamb slain from the foundation of the world took place on Golgotha's ugly brow. But just as the Feast of Pentecost in the Old Testament followed the Feast of Passover, so did Pentecost follow the crucifixion. Everything in the Old Testament is symbolic and type of the New Testament. It's not erased by the New, it's fulfilled by the New. I didn't come to do away with the law. I came to fulfill the law. Amen? Jesus came to fulfill it. Amen? And that's what Pentecost replaced, was the law. The law was the relationship. The law was the covenant. Amen? And that's what was going on in the law when the fire came down on the mountain. That was the Mosaic covenant. That was the Mosaic promise. That was the Mosaic. But on the day of Pentecost, when the fire fell from heaven, that was the covenant of the church. That was the birth of the church, the relationship of us in the New Testament. And let me tell you, Pentecost is not an afterthought. It was God's plan from the dawn of time and before that. That's why I say Pentecostal church is the only church he ever birthed. It's true. Some people get offended when I say that, but it's true. Show me another church that was birthed. The church came alive on the day of Pentecost. It was a Pentecostal church. That's when the Holy Ghost came down and gave life. Amen? Let him breathe on me. Let him breathe on me. You see, the Holy Ghost is the breath of God. Amen? God breathed into man. And man became a living soul. That was the Holy Ghost. Amen. Let us make man in our image. The Trinity was included in the creation. And when he said that God breathed into man the Holy Spirit, the Bible said all scripture is given by inspiration. Amen. That word inspiration means God breathed. That's the Holy Ghost. Amen. They were moved on by the Holy Spirit of God. Amen. And he says in Ezekiel 37, I will cause breath to enter into you and ye shall live. And when did the breath come? When the wind blew, and the wind was a type of the Holy Ghost. Amen. It's when the Holy Ghost comes that life comes. Amen. He not only wants to give you water to give you life, he wants to give you the Spirit that gives you life. That's how revival comes, when I pour out water on him that is thirsty, floods on the dry ground, and I pour my Spirit out. Hallelujah. Amen. Oh, I get preaching tonight. I'm sorry, I can't help it. But God is sending revival.
Amen.
God is sending revival. Services like Sunday don't just happen. You can't plan them. You can't organize them. It's just a God thing, and when he's doing it, you better step in while the water's troubled. Maybe more coming. I don't know. He could hold off just to get your attention again. I don't know what he'll do, but I'm ready. Spirit of promise. Acts 1:8 says it's not only a spirit of promise, but it's a spirit of power. You'll receive what?
Power.
Oh, say it like you mean it.
Power.
Power. After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you. You see, a spiritless, a Holy Ghostless church is a powerless church.
Amen.
I told you, it's not by might, it's not by power, it is by my Spirit. You see, because guess what? When God told that to Zechariah, he showed him the candlestick, which is the type of the church, being fueled with a bowl of oil, which is the type of the Holy Ghost. Because if there's no oil in the lamp, you can't light the fire. And where there's no fire, there's no light. Where there's no light, there's no heat. Where there's no heat, there's no direction. Where there's no light, I want to tell you, if the oil stops flowing, the light goes out and the church shuts down. Where there's no oil, there's no anointing. Amen? And you might as well just close the four doors if there's no anointing in the service. If you just want a sermon and a song, why don't you go to the local social club?
Amen.
Go down to the Elk. Dallas, or go down to VFW, or they get the other spirits out down there. The wrong kind of spirits. But if we want God in the church, we got to open up. It's a spirit of promise, the spirit of power. And according to John 14, 16 through 18.
And I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comfort, that ye may abide with you forever. Even the spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but ye know him.
Not only is the spirit of promise, the spirit of power is the spirit of presence. Wow. I don't want to just dwell on Sunday, but I can't get away from it. There was a presence in this place that was not natural. When the priest can't stand to minister because of the cloud, it's not natural. And believe me, You know me by now well enough, I hope and I think, that you know that I want to preach.
Amen. Amen.
But when God shows up, it's not about preaching. And when the priest can't stand to minister because of the cloud, that's the presence. I believe the word should be preached every chance it can be preached, but when God, who is the word, steps in and takes supreme authority, there's a time you step aside because he's the one that's moving and working, and when the presence of his spirit comes in, I won't leave you comfortless. I'll send the comforter, I'll send the paraclete, the one who comes alongside to comfort you. I'm going to send the Holy Spirit into your life and into your heart and into your midst. I'm going to pour out my spirit. I'm not going to trickle down. When he pours it out, man, you can't stand. There's too much. It's overload. And you're no longer under the influence of the flesh, but when you get drunk in the spirit, I cannot tell you how many services through the years that we've had to have designated drivers and how many preachers and people I have physically carried out of the church, drunk in the Holy Ghost, unable to walk. Just incredible, because they're under the influence of the Holy Spirit of God. And that doesn't mean they just had a good feeling, because when you're under the influence, you walk in obedience. And my daddy always said, and you'll probably hear it Sunday if I get to preach, I don't care how loud you shout, and I don't care how high you jump, what matters is how straight you walk when your feet hit the floor.
Amen.
Nothing wrong with shouting and jumping. We need a little bit of that. We're emotional beings. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy emotion. That's your soul, your will, your emotion, your intellect. You give him all your emotions. People want to shut down emotion in the revival. They're shutting God out, because let me tell you, David danced. He got emotion. But it's not a matter of flaunting the flesh. It's walking straight after you've done expressing your love and your appreciation of him. It's how you live. It's the obedience that brings the next thing we're going to hear. I will pour out my spirit, which is a spirit of promise, a spirit of power, and a spirit of presence. Remember the cloud by day and the pillar of fire by night? That was his presence. That was the Holy Spirit going before the Israelites, giving them direction. If we're going to walk where he wants us to go, we got to follow where his presence takes us. Not where popularity and not where man's opinion takes us, where God's presence takes us. I will, Moses said, if your presence doesn't go, I'm not going. If your Holy Ghost doesn't lead us, I'm not walking there. Amen. I'm not here to please people. I'm here to follow the Holy Ghost. Why a lot of our churches have no anointing, you know, because they have followed popular preaching. They've followed the people's opinions. They've been more interested in the crowd than Christ. I want God.
Amen.
I want the anointing. And when that happens, you know, some people are afraid of Pentecost. They're afraid speaking in tongues will chase people off. Let me tell you what happened on the day of Pentecost. 3,000 got saved. Amen. Hallelujah. The tongues is a sign to the unbeliever. Amen. And if you're afraid tongues is going to offend somebody, you better think again. Oh, I hope Sister Blessing don't get happy tonight because I brought a guest. And if she gets a little one of those, oh, man, she'll chase off this friend that was brought. My mother, my first mother-in-law, she had a form of godliness. I don't think she knew the Lord. She'd never been in one of my crusades. I came home and preached in my dad's church, and she lived in town where my parents lived. And we had a little baby that a year before I had prayed over the parents. They couldn't have children, and she got pregnant, and then in the summer had the baby, and the baby was given 24 hours to live, complications, and they called me, and I ended up going to all the medical center and praying, and God gave me a word. But it was long story short, God healed the kid. Justin has little brother Austin. It was supernatural. They didn't expect the baby to make the flight, and the doctor told them so, but God had other plans. And God just did a supernatural work. The baby was born a forceps delivery, not a major problem. Born with a hole in the lung, part of the problem. But he swallowed mother's blood, which strep D infection. It's hard to treat infection in an infant that's newborn. And the equipment in Albany was breathing for the child, but not allowing the lung to heal. It was working the lung that with a hole in it. It wouldn't allow the lung to heal. And they said, your baby won't survive this. We're going to take your baby to Pittsburgh to the Children's Hospital, and we're going to put him on a machine called an ECMO machine, which will breathe for him without working the lung, giving the lung time to heal. The only problem is we don't expect the baby to make the flight. And when Dr. Wong, who got off the plane from Pittsburgh, stepped in front of them and said, do you know why we're taking your baby before we attempt this? They said, Hank said, yes, because it's our baby's only hope. It's his last chance. And the doctor looked and said, yes, it is, and turned and walked away. And I looked at him and said, Hank and Christine, I'm going to tell you something the doctor's not telling you. But I talked to the chief of staff on my way over, and he gave me another report. I'm related to him. He's my older brother. No, I'm not talking about chief of staff of Albany Medical Center. I'm talking about the great physician, Jesus Christ. And I said, he told me to tell you everything's going to be all right. God healed that little boy. He got a little brother, Austin. You know, he must be close to 30 now. Oh, my Lord. That long ago. Hallelujah. But I told my mother-in-law about it, when it happened. Well, that night, I was going to preach on signs and wonders and miracles. And she'd never been in the service that I preached. My oldest brother was there, John. John and Esther were here for a couple of years, when we first came for a New Year's Eve service. John was taking the offering that night. He was the usher. He was not up in front. He was standing there. About to receive an offering for his little brother. And they asked him to pray. And so his back is to the people. He's got two offering plates in his hand. And the Spirit of God comes on. Ooh, Jesus. Now he starts waving these things like this. I see his feet going. I said, oh Lord, here we go. He starts talking in tongues, backing up the eye. Oh Lord, I call shit. He comes. Dancing in the Holy Ghost up the aisle. There's my mother. signs and wonders and miracles, and I told the story about little Justin, and when I finished telling the story, he said, oh, by the way, I said that little baby's in the church right now, 3 months old. He lived 45 minutes away, and when they heard I was there, they came up. And although she saw a demonstration that might have frightened, she held in her hand the first miracle she'd ever held, because there's power. It's not just a performance. It's not just a crazy act. It's not just wildness. There's power. And when she saw, see, on the day of Pentecost, they saw the power behind the performance. They spake with tongues, but they knew it was supernatural, because how can you speak a language you've never learned? And you see, I want to tell you, don't you ever be afraid of God pouring out His Spirit on this place.
Amen.
Oh, I can't bring so-and-so, because Sister Blessing can erupt at any moment. Let her go. Hallelujah. The Spirit of God. I'll pour out my water, I'll pour out my Spirit, my grace, my Spirit. And finally, he says in verse 3, and I'll pour out my blessing. I don't know about you. How many have had enough burdens? Anybody ready for a blessing?
Yeah.
We don't preach on blessing in the church sometimes. Some churches have overkill, and that's all they preach is blessing, blessing, blessing. And there's no responsibility, and so I try to tend not to preach the blessing just to let it happen, but let me tell you, the blessing of the Lord maketh rich, and it addeth no sorrow. And he said, when I revive you, when I replenish you, when you've been depleted, I am going to send blessing. Amen. That's part of revival. Somebody tonight, when I share, when I teach, when I preach, I don't get up here just to talk. I believe God has a prophetic word. And you notice one thing about when I preach, I always want it to be practical. It's applicable. It means something to somebody. You can take it home. Somebody needs it, or I'm not going to give it. And somebody tonight needs to know God's about to bless your socks off.
Amen.
Wow. But I've been through so much breaking down. How can I get any blessing? Because he said, I'll pour out my blessing. He said, don't get satisfied with a little bit. Don't get a little satisfied with a trickle down. I want to pour out some big blessings. Amen. Oh, hallelujah. I feel that tonight. I don't preach that all the time. But when God anoints me, I have to say it. And I believe God's about to pour out some great big blessings on somebody. Because he didn't say, I'll trickle down the blessing. I'm going to pour out my grace. I'm going to pour out my Spirit. And I'm going to pour out my blessing. That's revival. What does the Bible say in Proverbs 10:22? The blessing of the Lord maketh rich. You got to have a lot to get rich, don't you? A little bit of change in your pocket doesn't make you rich. The blessing of the Lord maketh rich, and it doesn't mean rich monetarily. It means rich with everything he's got for you, whatever it may be. Whatever God gives is rich. But that means he gives a lot of it. Amen? Not a little bit. The blessing of the Lord maketh rich. That's got to be quite a bit of blessing. Start looking at the blessings God's given you. Salvation is the top of the list, man. Can you get anything greater than that? Thank you, Lord, for saving my soul. Thank you, Lord, for making me whole. Thank you, Lord, for giving to me thy great salvation so full and rich and free. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for peace like a river. Thank you for joy like a fountain. Thank you for love like the ocean. I thank you for grace without measure. I thank you for healing in my body. I thank you for healing in my spirit, healing in my mind. Lord, I thank you, Lord, that you provide what I lack. I thank you, my God shall supply all my need according to his riches in glory. But look at the blessing that God has poured into your life. Look at what he's done in you. Look where you could be and where you are. Oh, if you could see where Jesus brought me from and where I am today, then you would know the reason why I love him so. Hallelujah. Ezekiel 34 and verse 26.
Round about my hill of blessing, and I will cause the shower to come down in his season.
there shall be showers of blessing.
Anybody ready for a blessing?
Yes.
Anybody ready for God to do something supernatural?
Yes.
Job was. He'd been depleted. Everything was gone. The money, finances, the family, the friends, physical health, gone. Lost it all. You want to talk about a people going through a hard place. Job had just been there. But on the other side, I'll restore the years that the cankerworm and the palmerworm and the caterpillar have eaten. I'm going to pour water on him that is thirsty. I'm going to pour floods on the dry ground, and I'm going to pour my spirit out on you, and I'm going to pour my blessing out on you. And Job was blessed with a twice as much blessing. A double portion. Isn't that what Elisha got? A double portion. What did God say to Abraham? I will bless those that bless you. And in you shall all the nations of the earth be blessed. Not only am I going to bless people who bless you, but I'm going to make you a blessing to all those around you. The blessing of the Lord makes rich. God, we need it. Pour it out tonight.